Well, thank you, Dr. Organizer, and especially the Chinese University of Hong Kong, Chinese University, and also Harvard University, Beijing. You give me this opportunity to speak and explain to you something about, initial beginning of how do you understand Chinese society. You can say from the beginning till now. Well, I will not begin from the very earlier time, but just to give an impression that the way Chinese society you think of it, the way you understand now, I mean, how it was and what are kind of a, you know, the passages it's gone through over the decades. So, to begin with, because I know people have come from various backgrounds, academic backgrounds as well as various disciplines, but I'm sure that all of you must have understood the basic, framework of strong society, weak state, weak society, strong state. So the whole idea is that how do you put Chinese society as a state? Whether you put it society as a strong society and a state as a weak state. But in case of China, there is not one definition in which you understand all this. Rather, there is a kind of a different framework. Sometime it has been a very weak state and strong society. And then there was an attempt to reinvent Chinese society. And then later on, again, it went on to very autonomous, active socialist states. And that becomes very important in case of China, because normally we understand China as a kind of a very authoritarian party state. So the impression we get is that the China is a very, one party dominated state, where society will have a very minimal role to perform, right? But it has not been the case in case of China. Rather, if you look at from the very beginning, I mean, I don't want to take you to Opium War and all that, but I'm saying as early as 20th century China, when you have a very politically disintegrated kind of a system, you still have in China secret societies. Now, I'm sure you must have heard of secret societies, a kind of space where you can have a strong opposition against the state, but it never came as a kind of very dominant phenomenon, but it was very much there. And you have a history of China as a very important peasant movement. So you must have heard of Taiping. You must have heard of Boxer Rebellion, Mian Rebellion. So somewhere you get an impression that Chinese society A has been very autonomous, vibrant, as well as you can say active, where people, no matter that the space was not given to them, but they have maybe carved out a space for themselves. And of course, banditry. Banditry was a very important popular social phenomenon in China, which was a kind of a resistance. So what I'm trying to say is that a kind of a resistance, popular social forces, which were not allowed by the state as such, but very much there, even in the as early as imperial time. And why I go to imperial time? Because you have to really understand that how even in those days China, you have these very autonomous social forces. That is fine. And if you go on, so I will basically take you to imperial time. That is a kind of a China which we have inherited historically, politically. Then I take you to the revolutionary China a little bit. And basically cover imperial revolutionary together, not much. Then I take you to the post-revolutionary China. Why? Because there you have very strong state. And then of course the reform China, when the market economy came into being. And there you have a kind of a system where the society became more and more autonomous. Or society became more vibrant. The society has social forces become more diversified. Right? So let's see that what happened to Chinese society from the beginning. Well, have you heard of, there was a very important scholar in China, which is called Fei Xiaotong. Fei Xiaotong was a, important Chinese sociologist. So we have this idea of, looking at society from the Western framework. So what I'm trying to say is that we don't have to look at Chinese society from Indian framework. And we don't have to look at Chinese society from the Western framework. Rather, we have to look at Chinese society from the Chinese framework, and the kind of institutions they have evolved, the kind of actors which were there, the kind of forces which were there. So that is the one important thing which you have to understand. And in that case, Fei Xiaotong was an important pioneer sociologist in that field. And what he did, he tried to introduce a new kind of a system or institutions through which you can understand Chinese society. And one of the very important institutions was, family. So which you call Qiating or Qia. So Qia is a very important basic institution of China. And China has gone through a system of, very joint families, and you have this endogamous families and all that, where marriage was allowed, and women had a kind of a different status within those families. Then it goes on to kinship, lineage. So these were the three important social organization of China. And how the proper property was basically, property became important institutions, which actually empower some sections and disempower some sections. So family, lineage, kinship were important social institutions in China in those years. But if you try to understand Chinese society, it was not simply closed. Rather, even in as early as 30s, it was quite an open society. So you have this, you know, especially in those areas of coastal China, where you have Guangdong, and Guangdong, you know, is in the eastern part of China, which is close to Hong Kong. So you have these external forces coming in, and which has an impact. So village society was not very close those years. Rather, village society has an impact of market economy. So you have the silk industry, which was as popular in China as in 1930s. Of course, the depression, the world depression has had an impact on the silk industry. So land tenure, social organizations, the silk industry, and the exposure to the outside world, which actually were very important forces of China, even in those years as early as 1930s. So what I'm trying to say is that you have all these social institutions, you have all these, you know, external forces, which was kind of intervening in the village social life. But still, society was categorized as a village society. So agrarian society. Agrarian China. People have fascination with agrarian China. If you look at it, there are various works from Chinese sociologists to Western anthropologists who have described China in various, you know, forms. So if you can get hold of those works in your library and on, you will see. Categories and approaches, that's how I have described. And 20th century China, I'm basically talking about the imperial China, that, you know, the earlier time, the pre-revolutionary China, and then the revolution began in, you know, you can say 21 onwards. I'm sure you know all this history. When the CPC was very much formed, till 49, there was a kind of a revolutionary period. So it basically, lot of overhauling of the political system as such. I don't go into details of now, but that's what I'm trying to try to discuss all that. That Feixiao Tong, this is the name, you know, Feixiao Tong sociologist. You can get hold of his work. And some of his important works are, So he has written some of the important works, which is Peasant Life in China, China's Gentry, and Earth About China. China's Gentry is a very important, kind of a understanding about China's social structure. And when he talks about gentry, he talks about a kind of a class which came in political power through the, of course, passing the examination. So there used to be Confucius examinations which used to pass, and there used to be only few elite who could come to this imperial estate administration. And this gentry class has a kind of a nexus with the landlord in those years. So I'm talking about agrarian China. And this gentry class first become powerful, of course, because they have political power. And since they have a nexus to the economically important dominant landlord class, they have economic power as well. And through this, the Chinese imperial estate administration used to run. So he talks about Chinese gentry, that how it used to come through the important positions, through this Confucius classic examination, which means it was not open to the poor people, but basically the elite who could come up to this level. So politically, if you look at it, the power was distributed among the few social elite. That's the point that I'm trying to say. And so on the one hand, he described the peasant life, how was the peasant life, and I've told you the kind of institutions he explained, which is I just explained to you just now. And also, he talks about that how China was earthbound, which means that how the, you know, agrarian or agriculture was a very important phenomenon to understand what China was. There was a very important author, Carl A. Witzfogel, who talks about Oriental despotism, where he talks about that China was a hydraulic empire. So water-based societies where you have a agrarian civilization. So basically, you know, China was an agrarian society in the beginning. And the most of things depend on this agriculture, water-based networks, irrigation systems, etc., etc. Well, of course, China has also suffered a number of drought, starvation, and also a kind of, this water-based problems, which we used to have earlier. So the whole idea is that we also have to understand that how China, from purely being an agrarian society, transformed into a urban or modern society, the way you look at it now. So that's the whole idea I'm trying to give you now, that how in the imperial time it was based on this kind of agrarian social structure, and the way I will take you slowly, that how it has been transformed into a more urban-based, consumer-oriented, and a very transformed kind of a industrial society, right? Now, another important writing which you can look through Potter and Potter. So the fascination with agrarian China. Potter and Potter has an interesting work on China's peasants. So you can Google it later on when you go back. And also William Hinton. Now William Hinton is a very important, Western writer, who wrote about two works, Fan Shan and Shan Fan. So Fan Shan is the earlier history of China, and Shan Fan basically is upside down. So it talks about that how China was in 1930s and how it was transformed. So it has a two very important thick volume. Slowly one can go through it to understand more that how Chinese society used to function. So it was basically based on some kinship network, some lineage organization, some families which are very important in China. So these were all kind of a system in imperial administration where you have a few elite who used to control the economic power in their hand. And politically, the people who are in power, they have to work with this economic elite. So the point you try to get is that the central administration was not that powerful which could intervene into these local political affairs. So the point I come to now is that how the local forces were so powerful in China. When talking about agrarian society, I'm trying to say is that society was agrarian in nature, but it doesn't mean that it was so backward that it could not articulate its interest. So there was a kind of a, in the imperial time, of course there was a kind of a nexus. Then I go ahead, to explain to you that how even they tried to challenge these social powers, they could not challenge some of the local social forces. So that is another point which I come to. Now, after this, so how do you understand state-society relation? And I think by now I had enough explained to you that society was purely agrarian in nature and peasantry was a very fascinating subject. So you have a lot of writings on that till I would say 1970s. Most of the writings are on China's peasantry. Of course, in India also you have rural India talking about, but we never come out of it. We never talk about urban India. We still somehow stuck with the agrarian social relations. But in case of China, there was an attempt to put in order or challenge or transform this agrarian social relation. So there was a kind of a change from the agrarian society to a urban society. Now, peasantry was a very important social class. Now, this is another interesting point which you can think of understanding for your understanding. Now, peasantry, of course, was a illiterate kind of a class which doesn't have much opening to the outside world, but it was a kind of a class which was very which Mao Zedong thought that it was easy to mobilize. Now, the idea is why. And I'm sure that those who know the revolutionary history, you know that Marxist theory of revolution, where he thought that peasantry cannot be a very important social force, and how Mao has tried to reinvent China by saying that revolutionary potential lies with peasantry. So I'm sure that all of you can look at this revolutionary socialist, those who are familiar with the social history of revolution, they all know that the change, the basic contribution of Mao Zedong was basically to bring this dynamism of revolutionary social favor to the peasantry, which was not with the case, which was not simply told by Marxist theory of revolution. And that is why we talk about sinification of Marxism, where Mao has tried to give his own understanding, indigenous model of Marxism or revolution, which was different from the earlier theory of revolution. So this is a Mao's contribution to a Chinese case, where China has a unique model of development. You cannot understand China's model of development by looking at the Western theories or by looking at Indian theories. Rather, we have to understand the Chinese unique model of social transformation. And in that case, the peasantry was chosen to be a very important social class. And if you look at some of the very important, movies, in fact, China has a very interesting, later on, it was, I'll get the name of, author, sorry, the film filmmaker who made a kind of a documentary where the kind of, peasantry took it a battle against the Japanese forces. So I'm talking about, I'm taking you to anti-Japanese war, that was 37 to 45, that how peasantry changed into a revolutionary social class and it could fight a battle with CPC against the Japanese army. And the reason was that, though peasantry was not a politically important class, but the CPC has worked with them, through propaganda, through postal campaigns, because that was a kind of an illiterate class. So you cannot teach them. You cannot the model of political campaign was different. So the mode of mobilization, the mode of political campaign was basically through propaganda as well as through posters or through slogans or through folk songs. So folk songs was a kind of a phenomena which Mao Zedong has used to integrate the peasantry with a revolutionary social potential. And that was done basically in case of China during the revolutionary time. And the peasantry became such a politically motivated force, unlike what Marxist has talked about the revolution, that it actually fought a battle in Shaanxi. So if you look at Shaanxi, the northern area where the Japanese forces was coming from north to the entry to China and fought a battle against the Japanese army. Mm-hmm. And Japanese, of course, you will see lot of movies in China against the Japanese Imperial Army and all, that how they were trying to take away all the properties, demolishing the villages and burning this population, depopulating the entire villages. So this all kind of atrocity which were done. So peasantry as a force stood against them. And then it became a kind of a challenge to the state administration. So that's why I'm saying that now from where the challenge came, of course there was Kuomintang forces, there were CPC forces. And there was you all know that there was a kind of a in between. There was a problem within the KMT and CPC. But during that, sometime they became an alliance, then sometime they became uneasy alliance kind of a thing. But during the CPC-KMT, it basically the peasantry, which could fight a battle with CPC, which made them, and which also made the CPC to become legitimized political force after the revolution. So 49 became so important immediately after the Japanese war. Maybe if the Japanese war had happened, it would have taken CPC longer time to, you know, take a kind of a revolutionary or take a kind of a political legitimacy within China. So this is what the peasantry was actually generated, a kind of a, again, interest. And you have a very important social historian and revolutionary theorist like Thaddeus Corpol. I'm sure those who are teaching comparative politics and governments, they'll be knowing about her name. Thaddeus Corpol, she wrote a book on social revolutions in the modern world, and she actually compared three kind of revolution: French, Russia, and China. Where she tried to explain that, you know, the fascination, what makes peasantry so revolutionary in China. So there was a fascination on peasantry with it as a revolutionary social class in China. If you look at it, another interesting thing which was also important for them is that how could peasantry being a revolutionary class could challenge the imperial state administration. So these are some of the important, you know, questions against raised during the imperial time, and people have actually worked, and this Thaddeus Corpol work is still a classic to understand the social revolution if you have interest on that why China did not go through a state-led revolution, how China managed to go through a social revolution. That's the whole point, that it was not a state-led development, it was not a state-led change or state-led transformation, rather it was a society-driven transformation. That was the point, that, you know, it was basically from the below that the change was supposed to come. Of course, the CPC now became a kind of an umbrella forces which has channeled this kind of a social forces into a revolutionary battle. Right? And she explained, you can read her work, you know, slowly when you get time. She explained that, you know, how China had actually inherited an agrarian bureaucracy. Now this is very interesting, because normally you understand bureaucracy as a very rational legal force, as if you understand the Bavarian kind of a notion. But she has actually explained that agrarian bureaucracy, why? Because there was a kind of a nexus, again, she says, between the, as I told you about gentry, that bureaucracy was basically based on the landlord class. So it got a backing from the landlord class, and of course, people who came to the power, they had a kind of an economic nexus with this kind of a very important dominant economic class in the society. So it was not something which is very independent from the social forces. It was somewhere embedded. The power was embedded in this kind of a social force itself. So it could not simply be away. And this kind of an agrarian bureaucracy actually was basically working on the taxes which was imposed on the peasantry to a large extent. And landlord class could not give generate revenue for the state unless until they get taxes from those peasantry. So these were some of the earlier fascination she went on to explain, that why the revolution came from the peasantry person. Because they were so much exploited. They were so much taxed by this landlord class. So they were all set to, you know, break those kind of imperial social barrier. And that is why they became a revolutionary social class. So that's how she went on to explain this. she did a very interesting historical and comparative method of explaining three revolutions. So she compared France, Russia, and China. That how, so she basically said the state administration was not capable enough. And she used the term incapacitation of the state administration against this powerful agrarian landlord class, which could not challenge these local forces. I leave it to you guys. You can read slowly when you say. Yeah. Another interesting, important point which I wanted to say is that, even in those years where you have this imperial state administration and the Confucius classic examination made people to come to the political power, still you have this locally very important social institutions like kinship, association life, clientele ties. Now, in case of China, Prasenjit Dwara, he has a very interesting work on state power and it's on local nexus of state power. Correct thing, the title of the book I can tell you later. Prasenjit Dwara has actually explained that how China, even in those imperial time, had a very strong associational life. So you have various kind of associations. Like you have, in those years, coolies. Coolies are very important kind of a social force. So you have coolies associations. Then you have this, water carrier associations, or you have this women associations and all that. So in those years as well, you have this association life, which used to, some people confuse it as a kind of a civil society. I'm sure that you all have a fascination whether China could have had a civil society. Of course, it may not have so much of power as you have, talking about raising their public opinion. But the point which is very important is that China had a very strong association life. And he talks about the local nexus of power, in the sense that even in those years, even in those, era, how these powerful associations were used to work as a parallel to the state administration. And religion. Now, religion, of course, the way we understand in India is very different the way we understand in China. But you have these local deities and local temple associations, which also was a very kind of an independent social forces, which used to go parallel to the state administration. So what I'm trying to say is that there was a kind of a state administration as well as the parallel social forces, which was equally powerful working against the state. Now the state was actually trying to govern the society through very, very important state administration by this, gentry class, by this Confucius, people who pass through Confucius examination and come to the political power. But they sometimes find it difficult to penetrate into this group of social forces. So this is an entire puzzle that I'm trying to explain to you guys, that how the state administration, of course, it has all this powerful social forces, social class, Confucius gentry with them. But still, the parallel social forces were so powerful that they were not able to penetrate. And to understand that, you have very important work by Vivian Shu. Now, Vivian Shu has wrote a book on reach of the state. Then where did the reach of the state end it? And how far it could actually go on into this kind of a social forces. So it has a very interesting take on that as well. So you can see a lot of fascination from this, understanding revolutionary China or the imperial China or the post-revolutionary China. So and she has used the term peasant localism. The meaning is that, and she has used this category of center and periphery. Now, center basically means a state, and periphery is a kind of a social forces. And she's saying that even in those years, of course, peasantry was a kind of peripheral social forces, but the state still feel it difficult to intervene into this kind of a peripheral social forces. So the localism in China is still very important, and it was there even in earlier years. And you can see the very fact that you have a peasant rebellion, you have the peasant social rights, which actually indicated that the local social forces are very, very competent as well as very actively being present in those years in China. Only thing is that you have to really understand that how much they could challenge the state power. So some phases, imperial time, you have a weak state. So they could, they became a very revolutionary social force. But now I come to Mao's time, where you have a very highly bureaucratized, centralized state. Passing through this imperial China, I take you to this post-revolutionary society where actually Mao Zedong, what he did, he tried to, in a way, which I'll talk about in the next lecture, reinventing Chinese society. So I'll come to that in the next lecture, so I'll not take you there. But what it did is that it tried to impose a kind of a centralized, bureaucratized state. Now, what does it mean that it tried to impose its own social categories, it tried to impose its own social institutions. Have you all heard of collectivization? So I'm taking the period from 50s to 70s. Until now, I was covering a period from, you know, early 20th century till, you can say, the revolution. Now, 50s to 70s, some of the various kind of social institutions were actually introduced in China. Collectivization, agriculture production, commune, right? And hukou and tanbe, I'll tell you later, you know, in the next lecture, what was hukou and tanbe. Now, this kind of a, you know, state administration, which was actually introduced by Mao. I don't know what you understand by commune. I think the idea was basically shared agriculture so that everybody will get according to their need. So the idea was to establish socialism and slowly communism in China. That was the basic idea. But the point which actually people somehow, you know, miss it is that to organize social life differently. And what Mao has tried to do, he tried to secularize society through introducing new kind of a social institutions. So it's not simply that, you know, you introduce agrarian reform. Through this agrarian reform, you also again try to introduce a new kind of a social mechanism. So everything, what is the main idea of collectivization? The collective in the village is everything. And people are supposed to harvest according to the order given by the collective organizations. That is one. And then you're supposed to give it back to the collective as well. So there was no market as such. So market which was there in the revolutionary China was simply, you know, in a bit dissolved. So the idea was that the people are only tied to the state. So you, whatever you produce, give it to the state, and the state will give you in the welfare packages. So you're kind of a contract system, which was introduced in those years of China between the state and society, social contract mechanism, that you do this much and you get your welfare packages. But you cannot think of a life beyond those state overarching institutions. Present in those years of China could not think anything. Suppose, you know, you wanted to grow, not you don't want to grow grain, you want to grow something else. You cannot do it. Because the collective leaders will ask you to do that. So that's, and but it doesn't mean that they will give something in return as well. So there was a welfare packages. So you do this much of work, and I'm sure you must have heard of, you know, work point system. That was the time that, you know, everybody was given a work point system. According to that, people were given a kind of a share in the harvest. So no money actually goes into you. Wages, etc. were not allowed in that sense. So people don't have income in those years. Rather, you have a kind of a welfare package which was tied. And I'm sure those who are, kind of sensitized to the women's liberation point of view, cultural revolution was a very interesting point where Mao Zedong gave this idea of, you know, what men can do, women can do too. And he talks about iron girls, that, you know, women are very, you know, actively social force. And greatly forward, particularly was the time where he said women has to participate in the economic and social production. So this was some of the very interesting idea, women hold up half the sky. So some of the ideas which actually gave by Mao Zedong in 50s and 80s by introducing this idea of a social equality. So the fascination was with the social equality. And the idea was that everybody will get the equal share so that there will not be any problem with this thing. So rural countryside was divided into a kind of a, so there was a boundary, rural and the urban. And of course some scholars have criticized that there was an urban bias. But I would say there was a point which Boston has done by dividing the population to rural and the urban categories, by making them to tie to particular boundaries so that the exodus to the urban areas can be controlled. So all this problem which came later because of migration, especially in case of India, you don't see much in case of China, like slums and all that. You don't see much in case of China. Why? Because they have very interesting model of social equality, that you remain in the rural areas, and that's where the social welfare packages have been guaranteed to you. Right? And then, of course, women participation, etc., etc. And with this kind of a model, what Mao Zedong has tried to do, he also tried to dissolve, or maybe you can say, a weaker. I'm not saying abolish. So you have to understand that point, because it means a society, some of the important institutions you can never abolish. Because Chinese society has very important kinship, temple, religion, as well as the lineage organization. So he never could abolish all them, but he tried to weaken them, so that the state became a very important force. Because after revolution, the whole idea was basically to unify China, to make China to work towards economic and social reconstruction, right? And you all know, he gave the idea of a great leap forward. So overtake Britain in 15 years, overtake US in 20 years. So that was the whole fascination of the socioeconomic reconstruction which Mao Zedong had, right? Socialism. So he tried to weaken all these kinship organization, lineage organization, temple associations, which was there in the literature, and tried to impose new culture. Or you can say introduce, I will not say impose, because he was trying to introduce by taking people into confidence, these social institutions of collectivization, etc. And very interestingly, if you look at it, association life, since I said association life was very important in China, they have introduced, you know, women's organization. So you still in China, you have this All China Women's Federation, very important, office you have in Chin Kong and in Beijing. And in those years, this Women's Federation in China, as well as peasant associations, as well as this labor unions, the idea was that, you know, people have used this term of state cooperatism. State cooperatism means that these were associations were there, but they were not independent from the state power. Rather, they were very much a kind of a transmission belt. Now, when I'm saying transmission belt, which means that they used to carry the order from the state and articulate those interests among those social forces. So Women's Federation will do what they have asked to do. And what is their basically work? To mobilize the people, mobilize women to participate in the economic and social production. Of course, it has other social means also. For example, you know, property ownership law was introduced, marriage law was introduced, land reform law was introduced. So all that social transformation measures were taken very actively even in those years China. Even if all that, say, peasant associations. So all these associations which were there, they very much fall within the framework of state cooperatism, where it was not an independent associations away from the state. Rather, they were very much part of the state capacity to govern, you know, how to take interest of, so that it can never become a kind of opposition to the state power. So that's how they did. They introduced these mass organizations representing women's interests, labor interests, as well as the peasant interests, which could take care of all these interests in the so that it can never become a challenge to the state. That is a very important, you know, kind of thing. So mass mobilization and state cooperatism. And there's a, Anita Chan is a very important author who wrote about this state cooperatism as a concept, that how it was introduced in those years, so that there was no protest. Now, protest is a very important phenomenon now in China. You see a lot of social protests happening in a small scale. But those kind of social protests you never see in China. Why? Because you have these kind of associations which promises to articulate and represent the interests of those social classes, right? In those years, you also have this very important administration, local administration, right? You know, China has a kind of a hierarchical state administration. You have a centralized state administration, and then it goes down to the local level. So China has this very important administrative unit, provinces, county, township, or village. That's how they divided the China into various administrative structure. Like you have district here, district talukas and all that. So China also has those kind of, you know, provinces. Provinces like a state. So Guangzhou or, you know, Anhui, Hebei, Henan, these are all provinces in China. And then, of course, municipalities, which is a very independent political unit, administrative unit. And it goes down to further. Now, county is a very important ruler social unit. And it goes down to county, township and town. So this kind of a local administration was there in earlier days also in China. But those local administration was basically only to help the state to govern. They never had in the kind of an independent administrative power per se. But still, if you look at, you know, you people who have read about Greatly Forward and Cultural Revolution, and they said that why Greatly Forward failed and all that. So you know very systematically that how the local data were actually manipulated by the local officials. So somewhere there was a kind of a localism was still present in those years of China. So Mao Zedong has tried to weaken those institutions, or has tried to, you know, introduce new social mechanism, more secular kind of a social mechanism. But it could never become a kind of a dissolve in the society. So why now, when you have a new market economy in China, all these social forces have come up again? So that's the point. So it was there earlier, but it never got dissolved. But it has now resurfaced again, all these institutions. So the state, of course, in the imperial time, got a challenge of them, because there was a kind of different fascination of the revolution time. And then when you have this liberation period, they were trying to unify as well as stabilize the government. And now, with this new set of a market economy, well, the market economy has changed most of the things, in the sense that you have this, you know, intervention of global capital coming in. urbanization has become a very important phenomenon, consumerism, lifestyles, and then the whole contract which used to have with the state and individual has somewhere been ruptured. How? See, the state used to promises that, as I told you, through this collectivization and the urban boundary, it has divided society into two boundaries, rural and the urban. And it used to ensure that you are part of this rural boundary, you are giving this kind of package. Now, once you have the market forces, all these boundaries which were drawn between the rural and the urban area was completely dissolved. Or you can say, become more fluid. One important, interesting example is migration. The people can migrate from the village to the cities. And the rural-urban migration became a very interesting phenomenon. I'm sure you will have lectures on that, so I will not discuss much on that. But it has transformed the people's life in a significant manner. Now, in the same way, what is happening is that with this kind of a, you know, change in this state-state relation, the relation between the individual and the state also got changed in a significant manner. So now, the state doesn't use these social forces for mobilization. So all this idea of mass mobilization, all this idea of, you know, associations of people for the articulation of the state interest, somewhere got ruptured. And now individuals are becoming kind of an autonomous entity. Right? So you have, you know, for example, I always teach in my class leisure time. You know, leisure time in China, which you never had in the earlier time. You always work for the state, you always work for the, you know, mass mobilization, you always engage, be a part of political campaign. You always be a part of, you know, Marxist, learning about Marxist theory and the study of society, etc., etc. But now you have, if you look at Chinese society, people are more free. Yeah, you know, the public parks, public park in China, which is very important, you know, to understand that how people spend their time is a very important space to understand. You know, people are busy in, you know, any kind of a, there will be a movie show, there will be a dancing, there will be a different kind of a, you know, performances, they will be doing Tai Chi Chuan, they will be doing martial art. I mean, people are come out of their houses on the weekend, you will see in the public park, it's a much more vibrant social phenomena where people are free to do whatever they want. So, and then the whole range of activities, entertainment. Like, you know, every time people ask, you know, democracy is something which Chinese miss. No. Why? Because they have so much of, you know, entertainment, leisure, as well as the free space as it is, which for us sometimes is difficult to imagine that, you know, so much liberation has happened in terms of people's time as such. So you have WeChat, Weibo, etc., all this entertainment mechanism. Plus you have this, you know, Wi-Fi connection. So internet users in China, I'm sure you may be getting this figure much higher than it used to be in other countries as such. So people, so this leisure time, which means that which was never a phenomenon in those years in China, has become a kind of a reality in Chinese social life. And with this new kind of forces of urbanization, consumerism, new lifestyle. So if you look at the urban cities of China, you have this all kind of a range of malls and you know, kind of dresses. If you look at it, what people have in Chinese society, as well as the hairstyle, etc. Everything you look at, it looks like you have an impression that people are enjoying kind of a consumer social life, which is very different from the earlier time. So this is a big shift. And this big shift has happened by, because you have this introduction of the market forces, where people are more free to perform the way you want. Of course, it has created a kind of a different social vulnerabilities as well. So society, which was actually in Mao's time, which was only divided into two sections, you know, workers and the peasant, cities and the countryside, rural and the urban, all got ruptured. All got, you know, completely different in with this onset of market forces, or, you know, with this arrival of the global capital, or with the arrival of market forces as well as market economy. And now you have a new forces. For example, now even in urban areas you have various kind of a social forces. For example, migrant workers. The migrant workers sometimes ask for citizenship rights. So there's a studies on that. Hukou rights, because hukou is very important social institution in China. Then you have this for example, women. Now, women of various kind, migrant women. I'll come to hukou in the next you know, lecture. You have women of all kind. You have you know, women working in the migrant women categories. You have women working in the social agrarian women categories. You have entrepreneurial women. Women are becoming a very important independent economic force in case of China now. So you have what I'm saying, the social groups have become so diversified in China. So what you have, you will see a kind of a new social forces which have come up in case of China. Minorities, ethnic minorities. I'm sure you all want to know what happened to, so you don't have we have in India this caste, class, etc. That kind of a system China has transformed much earlier, even Mao's time. So China has gone through transformation. I'm sure you all know about land reform program, which has actually tried to abolish to a large extent the property-based social inequalities in China. So from that time onwards, the land reform was a very important active social integration measure in those years. Now, those kind of a property-based inequalities, of course, are coming back in different ways altogether because of the two reasons. A, the land has become now, commodification of land has happened, which means that the land which used to belong to the state earlier has now much more commercialized. So suddenly you will see a mushrooming of all new set of commercial enterprise in Chinese cities as well as villages. So villages, the village I began with, right, earthbound China. That is no longer in China now. China has become much more freedom. People can engage in various kind of occupations. So you have different occupations, like peasantry, for example. They don't have to work as a round-the-year labor on the farm. Rather, what they can do, they can also give the farm on the rent to others. They can also lease the farm to the collective organizations, to the companies. So there's a new set of agro-based companies which have entered into this kind of an owner scene. So there's a massive changes. If you look at urban areas, there used to be SOEs, so much more to all that. So what is happening is that you have a new social groups which have emerged, and with that, a new kind of a conflict and resistance also begin. So I'm actually trying to say is that now society which you look at in China is actually, there's a conflict more because the groups have been identified. But those new groups will never give a challenge to the state power. Why? Because somewhere they have seen a kind of an articulation of the interest. So there is a protest. Yeah, I'm referring to this, you know, as I said, women of various kinds. For example, migrant women, urban women, then you have entrepreneurial women, the ethnic minorities, then you have this Muslim populations also get all together, which comes under ethnic minorities as well. Then you have students, or you have youth demonstrations, for example. Or you have sometimes, you know, this urban migrant workers, as well as the urban, industrial workers, factory women. So there are studies on all that. I've just listed some of the factory studies. Qingpeng Li, I'm sure, worked on factory women workers. Then you have land disputes, if you want to look at it. You have Peter Ho, David Zhu, who called people. So there's a whole list of, which actually sometimes gives an impression to the people that, oh, the society is actually sitting on, you know, a lot of turmoil, which can erupt any time. No, it can never happen in China. Because why? Because, you know, when the state realizes that there is a kind of a, as I said, the contract has ruptured, and there is a kind of a social force which has emerged in a different way, it has given them certain channels to articulate their interests. And these channels have actually taken a form of a social protest, some kind of a contestation which has begun, some kind of a social conflict which has begun. So, but this kind of a conflict and contestation are actually in a different kind of a small forms. For example, contestation for land dispute, contestation for minority rights, contestation for youth demonstration. So these are very small kind of a small scale protest, which will never take in a form of a large scale social movements of earlier time. So people have, you know, tend to say that are these social protests are like social movements? No. Because these protests are fragmented, A. B, the state allow these social, forces to come up and contest. So they can, you know, they can give some kind of a compensation. Or the state has actually tried to accommodate these interests in some ways. So what I'm trying to say is that the state is not going in opposition to these social forces. Rather, the state is trying to play a very balanced role, where it is somewhere accommodating their interest or somewhere representing their interest as well. So that's why these kind of a social protests can never take in a form of social movements in China in a big way, the way it happens in other countries as well. And it could never challenge the state power in such a way. Because I know there is a kind of a fascination among some of the Western scholars, will China collapse? Will China will lead to a complete, you know, will there be a demise of one party rule in China? Will China will look for democratization? No. Because somewhere, state has opened this kind of a channels for this kind of a protest policy. So what I'm trying to say, the fascination with this rural China is now over in a big way in China, and you have a new set of studies on all these issues. So the peasantry as a social class, even peasantry as a class has changed. You have a now, peasantry has introduced themselves as a farmers. So I remember, because I will tell you the next, you know, I'll show you some of the pictures. We are, of course, they say that we are the peasant, but the peasant, the way you understand, tied to the land, which is not there in China any longer now. Rather, you have peasant much freer. They enjoy much free social space. For example, I told you that they can become a tourist guide, they can become work in agro-based companies, they can work, they can completely abandon the land and can actually migrate to the cities. So all this have transformed the identity of the social groups. So peasantry is no longer a peasantry as used to be in the Mao's time. It has completely been diversified to various categories. Urban workers also has been diversified to various categories. Women again. So that's how you can take this example. So no longer the social categories which were introduced by Mao are there in China. It has a diversification of social categories in today's time. And that led to a, for example, I gave example of this factory women workers. So you have, you know, factory women, you have rural migrant women. So this is a kind of a, how do you understand the new trends in Chinese society? Right? Now, as I said, it's no longer a alien China, right? It is trying to become much more urban-based, much more consumer-oriented kind of a society. So urbanization is a very interesting phenomenon in China. And if you look at it, some of the works which I have identified is Golden, very fascinating work of, and the title of the work says, Farewell to Present China. That's the title of his work, Golden. So which actually indicate what I'm trying to say is that the present China is actually no longer, you look at it, rather it's a kind of a new set of categories which has emerged. So he actually did a field work in various Guangzhou province and etc. and then tried to introduce that how rural urbanization has become a kind of a new social reality in case of China. Another interesting thing which I also want to say is that Yu Tianxi, now this I found very interesting work by her, is about great urban transformation. And why I'm saying this, because I also somehow work on these issues, land and property regimes in China. Well, in case of China, the land actually belongs to the state. It's no longer an individual ownership per se. So most of the enterprises has somewhere been sanctioned by the state as per se, which means that if you want to start a kind of a new industries, enterprises, etc. If you want to use the land for the commercial enterprises, one has to take the land from the state. And now with this new kind of a land laws changes, of course earlier you have a one land law, which means that it divides the land from the ruler and the urban. But now you have very interesting new categories. So you have to really get into details of all that. What is land law all about? How they divided the law and land into ruler and urban categories. But with this new kind of definition, new kind of a changes, the rural land can be given to a commercial purposes as well. So people have worked on various aspects of all this, and Yoshi and Tan is very interesting work, one of the very interesting work on that. Now what is happening is that these land now can be used for the various kind of a, you know, commercial enterprise, which means that the state itself become a kind of an actor into these enterprises management, which means that the state no longer a kind of a state which you understand in Mao's time, of course, social transformation and all that. Rather, there's a different studies on the state per se. It has changed from a, people have used the term cooperative state, where the state has become a kind of an entity in all kind of a economically powerful business interest. So the state is very much a stakeholder in the business interest of the Chinese society, which means that whatever units, whatever commercial enterprises you set up, the state party cadres are very much a part of all those commercial enterprises. So because the land belongs to the state, and it has evolved a various property mechanism. What are the property mechanism? For example, it has, it has actually kind of a de facto privatization, where the land can be given, for example, on lease. So you have a land for 30 years, you can run those enterprises, and you can give a kind of a rent to the state. Which means that the state role become very minimal. But the state will see to it that the enterprise has to be profit-oriented, so that it can actually become a kind of a, you know, partner. Because some of the party cadres also become a part of this kind of enterprise management. So state is not simply a kind of a poor state in China, rather state in China is a very powerful state, which has a lot of economically very important, powerful machinery, which has enough resources, and which is very much important, which is very much visible in a kind of infrastructure development you see. The kind of connectivity projects China has introduced, the kind of, you know, development mechanism, the kind of, you know, change in the people's lifestyle. It all could not have come without the, you know, the support of the state. And the state supporting all those things, of course, the initial idea was basically China to attract the investment from outside. Now China is actually going out. So they say, you know, going global is a kind of a strategy, which basically means that it is actually able to invest in other countries as well. Now this, it is possible because of the huge capital they have, you know, have gained access to. And this kind of capital they have, you know, gained. The one reason, of course, they will marry, but the one reason basically is also about the commodification of all this land and other communities, which was not possible in earlier time. So the land can be given for the commercial purposes, which means that a lot of capital can come inside, where the state becomes a partner to all these kind of investment agencies. So what I'm trying to say is that the state is actually become a kind of a, you know, not a interventionist in that sense, where you have the social transformation as an important goal. Rather, you have a kind of a facilitating agency, which is actually supporting this kind of economic development, profit-oriented kind of enterprises in that sense. So this is how a kind of a new twist which has happened in case of, and which has of course implication for the standing society as well. So more urban infrastructure projects have come up. And this could not have come up if they would not allow the land to change from the rural land to a urban land. And once these urban infrastructure projects have come up, it has taken away the huge land from the county administration. The county, as I told you about the rural unit. So it has taken the land and the county has been transformed into a part of the municipalities. So you will see a huge transformation in China, where the municipality has taken a huge land, you know, outside their boundaries, and that's what she described, Yu Xingting also described, that, you know, there's a whole idea of an urban core and the peripheries. So the how the core has been, you know, has been extended to the rural peripheries as well, and which has a, of course, has changed the rural landscape completely. So now if you travel to China, you will see, where's the rural China? You hardly see rural China. What you see is that people are having a greenhouse cultivations. So all this open field, where you will see people working on manually in China, is no longer existent. Rather, you have a greenhouse cultivation with a huge mechanization, commercialization of you know, agrarian products, where the China is moving more towards a cash crop cultivation, as well as a more faster pace of cultivation. So this is a new forms of kind of agrarian mechanization you see in China. So the rural landscape which you see in the earlier social histories of Chinese in the agrarian landscape is completely changed. Now you will see a huge multi-story apartments, massive infrastructure projects, urban transformation. That has become a reality of China now. And with this, a kind of a shift which has happened in the, when you try to understand the social, you know, the society in China. The society in China has become now. So there's a new study which tried to understand China, the Chinese society through this urban society. So what happened to the peasantry, for example? If you transform the rural area into the urban landscape, what happened to the peasantry? So in case of China, of course, the urban compensation has been given to them. So they have been changed from the, rural landscape to the urban city life. So once they transform from the rural village household to the urban city life, what are the challenges they face, for example? Is the transformation is actually led to a kind of a change in the lifestyle? So these are some of the questions which actually people are trying to address in some of these new kind of studies, that how the urban transformation has changed the people lifestyle, that is one. How they created a new form of social vulnerabilities, or third, how they have created a new form of a social identity.